This is Wraith from Wraith Rain. I'm an author of serialized gay romance fiction. Every week on this podcast, I'll be reading a chapter from one of my gay fantasy shifter serials called Dragon's Reign. I'll explain at the break how you can find out more about this story and others I write. So let's get to it. Chapter 40, Thankful. Earlier.
I think I should shift now, you know, before he gets to the part in his speech introducing me, so I'll be able to just burst up, Caden told Rose.
He rubbed sweaty hands on the fronts of his boxer briefs. He'd stripped down to those because they would be easy to rip off at the right moment. Being naked in public would have caused him some embarrassment, but they were sheltering in a recessed doorway, which kept them mostly out of sight. The door supposedly led to an empty warehouse, but it was an exit for one of the many secret tunnels that ran through Reach like the city was a gigantic block of Swiss cheese. Rose's eyebrows rose up into her hairline, which was illuminated nicely by her phone. She was watching one of the newscasts of Valerius' speech, the one that Shione was being interviewed on.
Look, I know this is an alley, but people from the square are walking right past the end of it, Caden. They'll see your big white butt.
Iolaire craned its neck around to see its butt. It started to go in a circle as it couldn't quite see. Apparently, Iolaire believed that it could win a race against its own behind.
Iolaire's butt is perfectly proportioned, I'll have you know, and you shouldn't fat shame, he told her.
Rose let out a bubbling laugh. Sensitive about your rear end, are you?
Not all of us are delicate insects, Rose, he retorted,
then let out a snicker himself. Rose started fully laughing then. Caden wrapped his arms over his bare chest as his own snickers turned to hysterical gales of laughter. Rose poked him in the side.
Ow! What did you do that for?
Caden scowled at her, his laughter dying down to occasional outbursts.
You were drawing attention.
She tilted her head towards the end of the alley.
Captain Nagoye has people blocking the exits. They won't let anyone get too curious, he said and gestured towards the plains-clothed claw that were at each end of the alleyway.
True, but you were also hysterical, Rose said with a sniff.
I was not hysterical!
His voice rose up rather hysterically. He grimaced.
Okay, maybe I'm a little hysterical. Has he said the word? Is he close?
He hasn't even arrived yet. Rose said dryly. Did you see his big black butt in the sky?
What's with you and dragon butts? Total sizist.
He shook his head, hiding a smile, but soon he didn't have to hide that smile as he was anxiously frowning again.
What?
Rose asked, her eyes sliding towards him and then back to her phone.
What if I can't do it?
She frowned. What if you can't do what?
Shift!
He bounced up and down on the balls of his feet.
What if Valerius says, and here is Iolaire, and nothing happens? The sky remains empty because I'm stuck in this alley.
She didn't even give him a sideways glance this time. You will shift.
You don't know that. I've had problems before. It's like when people watch you pee, he explained.
She let out a cough that was suspiciously like a laugh.
I won't watch you shift then. I don't mean I'm nervous about you watching, so you wouldn't mind me watching you pee?
Gross. Caden, I'm so not into that kind of kinky, she smirked. He groaned and leaned his head back so that he could see the sky. It was a beautiful night. Despite the light pollution from Reach itself, there were quite a few stars to be seen, and the moon was high and huge in the blackness. Rose put a hand on his shoulder.
It'll be fine. You'll shift. You're practically ready to jump out of your skin as it is. That's just it. I should shift now when I have the time to make a mistake. Oh God, there he is!
Caden's right hand shot up to the sky where the magnificent black dragon had appeared.
Calm down. He still got to land and say the speech and then the word and then I should shift now.
Caden bounced up and down rather like he was on a pogo stick. Rose dug her fingernails into his bare shoulder.
Ow! That's the second time you've hurt me.
Oh, please, you big baby. You're a dragon shifter. Your hide is dragon scales that are like impregnable. Rose rolled her eyes.
Listen, you need to keep it together for like 10 more minutes. Then you can shift and lift butt into the air. I just don't want to mess anything up, he admitted. Valerius hates giving speeches.
You don't say.
I would have never noticed the grimacing throughout his other speeches, she remarked dryly.
Yeah, exactly. It's like pulling fingernails. So if I embarrass him, it would be nothing less than he deserves, Rose said. Hey, Valerius is awesome. He is. But he's treated ruling like it was a chore for him. That's allowed all these other jerks to do bad things, not just out in the world, but here in Reach. He should never have allowed Marban.
Marban? What shouldn't he have allowed Marban to do? Caden tilted his head to the side.
No, Marban is there behind you, Rose choked out.
Caden swung around, and the grandfatherly swarm shifter was standing there, smiling benevolently at them. He was dressed in a rather snazzy set of purple and gold robes, looking all the part of a wise sage.
Whoa, what are you doing here, Marban? Caden asked as he took a few steps back in surprise.
I came to see His Majesty's speech, of course. I am the head of the Shifter Council, after all, Marban reminded them.
Did Shioni call you? Rose's eyes were narrowed.
She did, granddaughter. I am being treated respectfully, which I am certain that is why you asked that question, he answered her with equally narrowed eyes.
Yes, exactly why I did.
But Rose didn't look like she meant that at all.
Yeah, make sure you're here for that, but why are you here, in an alleyway here? Caden asked.
He put his hands on his hips and stared hard at Marban.
Why, for you, young man, Marban smiled beneficently.
Caden and Rose exchanged disbelieving glances.
I'm not sure, Caden began.
The Claw are quite good at many things, but being discreet? Marban shrugged his shoulders. Their presence is screaming something is going on in this alley that people should be interested in. So I sent some of my people to divert those people away from here.
Caden glanced down at both ends of the alley and noticed that there were no longer any groups of people drifting past. Marban had stemmed the flow. Caden felt a wave of relief. The issue was off his shoulders. There was no chance now of anyone seeing him shift that shouldn't. Iolaire yawned. It wasn't concerned at all. It wanted to stretch its wings, but was content to wait.
Thank you. That was really helpful, Caden admitted.
Yeah, that is good, grandfather, Rose concurred, but there was suspicion in her eyes.
We must all do our part. Asked, but preferably unasked, to make King Valerius's plans go smoothly, Marban said.
I'll make sure he knows that you...
No need,
Marban put his hands up.
But I'm sure he'd be happy to know you did this. We sort of put it together last minute, Caden insisted.
Well, if you think him knowing will be useful, then I defer to you.
Another beneficent smile was sent Caden's way, and somehow Caden thought that this had been the plan all along, that Valerius would know about Marban's acts, but through Caden. Caden nodded absently. That sick feeling of anticipation mixed with anxiety was in his stomach. He looked over at Rose. She was still watching the speech.
Where is he in the speech?
We still have some time yet. She gave him a lopsided smile.
He's saying really nice things about you, Caden. Calling you a hero, which you are.
Really?
Caden leaned over to look at her phone. He heard Valerius say,
they were human, mortal, fragile. They fully expected to die when they leaped out into the drop. And that was when the spirit came and chose to be bound with them. That is the sort of person and spirit that the White Dragon Shifter is. Kind, compassionate, brave, selfless.
Caden blinked.
Wow. Do you suppose he really thinks that?
I don't think Valerius is the type to say what he doesn't mean, Rose said gently. Caden beamed, but then felt a little unnerved. How was he going to keep living up to those descriptions of himself? So far, he had completely been winging it and hoping that everything would end up all right.
I can't keep doing that any longer, Caden thought. I have to start thinking strategically and planning. What I do matters.
When Iolaire raised its head to gaze at him,
what we do matters, Iolaire. We've got to start planning. If you have some great wisdom to impart, you best let me know.
Iolaire yawned and laid its head down on its front claws so that it could get the last moments of rest before they shifted.
"You're thinking too hard, dear boy," Marban said as he patted Caden's shoulder.
"I don't believe I've been thinking hard enough." He hesitated, then told Marban, "Today at the shop, Jasper Hawes tried to trick me into shifting in order to protect my friend Landry."
Rose let out a huff of air. "Ha! I don't know if you can call her a friend anymore, Caden."
"It's her family, Rose. I get that they come first," he said, though he did feel a stab of sadness that Landry had betrayed him, seemingly.
"Her brothers are no good. They're racists. She was flirting with racism herself until she found out that you were the white dragon shifter," Rose pointed out. "I get if she felt loyalty to them if they were innocent or something, but they planted that bomb in the square."
"They were part of the smoke bombs, yeah, but we don't know who the shifter girl was who put the backpack down," Caden reminded her.
Marban's clever eyes flickered between the two of them.
"Let me see what I can do about Jasper Hawes."
"You have sway with humans first?"
Caden could not hide his disbelief.
"People who are willing to break the law to get what they want, are willing to stretch who they associate with in order to accomplish their goals. They always think they are smarter than those they are dealing with."
Marban's eyes narrowed and a cold smile crossed his lips. Caden realized then, if he really hadn't already, just how useful Marban could be to Valerius. While the Dragon King could stay into the light above the fray, Marban could dive deep to touch base with those people who Valerius could never or would never speak to.
"Do you think that humans first are behind these bombings?" Caden asked him.
"If they are, they have help from outside," Marban said.
"Like help from another territory?" Rose's gaze left her phone.
"Rose, watch!" Caden cried.
She quickly looked down. "He's wrapping up."
"I think help from another dragon shifter," Marban said, "but I do not wish to say much more. I don't have as much influence outside of Valerius's territory as it was like. Not enough to easily get to the heart of this conspiracy, but I am looking into it."
"Could it be Iolaire? I mean, he's the most obvious choice," Caden said.
"Yes, but perhaps too obvious. Iolaire is not, how shall we say, subtle. You saw his bizarre announcement, I suppose, about claiming his mate?"
Marban asked, his left eyebrow lifting with disgust.
Oh, yeah, I saw it. It was such bullshit. If he were the only other dragon shifter on Earth, I wouldn't be his mate," Caden scowled.
Marban chuckled. "Yes, I'm sure you would not. But notice how foolish he was to announce his plans to claim you. So when he doesn't, he will look like a weak fool."
"Totally. Not the type of guy that would have people planting bombs then," Caden agreed, nodding. "You should head to the square, Marban."
"Actually, you should head to the square right now, Caden." Rose slapped his bare back. Caden didn't have a chance to worry about whether he could shift or not. He took one step and he was shifting. Iolaire immediately took over and Caden could not be happier about that. He let the dragon spirit control their flight so that he didn't crash them into buildings or anything else for that matter. He looked down at the crowd in the square and was amazed at how very many people there were. He blinked as there were thousands of flashes from cameras taking pictures of them as they circled overhead. Valerius was gazing up at them too, and Caden could hear his thoughts.
"You are doing beautifully," Valerius said.
"I shifted, no problems." Caden winced a little at how proud he sounded of something so very basic.
Valerius chuckled. "Indeed you did, and you didn't need me to kiss you in order to do it."
"Are you thinking of that kiss too?" Caden asked. He felt Valerius blush.
All right, yes, I am. I cannot get it out of my thoughts, but we must be in control of ourselves."
"Iolaire is in control right now, otherwise I might have flown into the side of your castle." Valerius really guffawed them.
"I should have you knock into a part that I want redone. That would mean that Shioni would give me the funds to redo it."
"She holds the purse strings, yeah?"
Valerius grunted. "Yes, she does, in a very tight fist. She says we shouldn't spend anything unnecessarily, but I'm a dragon. I love my treasure."
Caden grinned at this lighter side to Valerius. The black dragon shifter's mood was buoyed not only by the crowd, but by that kiss, too. Caden found himself sinking into a serene sense of calm.
"I think Iolaire is taking us down. It's excited to have all the people pet it," Caden said.
"Petting?" Valerius groaned.
"It does not understand that people will then think it is appropriate to try to pet all dragon shifters. And that
could be disastrous. Aw, you're just afraid someone's going to try to pat your head.
Anyone tries to pat my head and their hair will be on fire, Raziel growled.
Raziel, you're talking to me, Caden crowed.
I am, Raziel said, but then nothing more.
Oh, okay, well, right, Caden blathered. Ah, touchdown! Iolaire gracefully extended its back legs so that it was almost standing on 2 feet, 20 feet above the platform, then slowly lowered. When it was 5 feet above the ground, Iolaire let itself drop to the ground. They landed almost lightly on the wooden platform. Iolaire tucked its wings back. The crowd oohed and awed. People pressed forward against the barriers. The claw had a difficult time in their hands, keeping people back.
Excellent landing, Flary said to him.
That was totally Iolaire. If it had been me, I think I might have crushed you, Caden laughed and then said to his dragon spirit. Good job, Iolaire.
Valerius addressed the crowd.
As you can see, Iolaire is a little smaller than me.
There was a ripple of laughter as well as the continuing flashes of cameras. Nearly everyone was filming this historic moment. The ninth dragon shifter was right there, practically within reach. There was suddenly a very loud crack. Valerius' eyes went wide. Shioni froze. Simmy went for his sword.
Whoa, Crane cried. What's that?
Iolaire made some chirping noises of alarm as it twisted its serpentine head right and left. Then there was a groaning sound before the platform collapsed beneath them. I hope you are enjoying Dragon's Reign so far. I've been talking a lot about the memberships that I have, but I also do publish individual books under the pen name X Aratare, which have the same type of adventurous plot, magic around every corner, and happily ever afters as Dragon's Reign. As you can tell, I am really into the clashing of two worlds, humans and shifters. In my 5-book series, The Merman, a gay merman romance, the people of the land and the mers of the sea collide. Will love overcome hate and distrust? A link to the Merman series is in the description down below.
Iolaire reached out and grabbed Captain Simmy in one hand and Valerius and Shioni in the other so that they didn't slide into the splintered mess that had been the platform. Then with a powerful flap of wings, Iolaire hovered above the ruined platform. The wood had splintered beneath the white dragon's considerable weight. Smaller than Raziel was true, but that hadn't meant big for everything else. There were gasps and cries of alarm from the crowd.
Everybody okay? Caden asked as he looked between Simmy and Valerius and Shioni.
We're fine, Valerius said, as he clearly regained his composure. His robe had fallen open, but his body was hidden from the public by Iolaire's claw.
Iolaire hooted at him softly to make sure that was really true.
Raziel responded, You are too big for that slender wood. I did tell Valerius it would be best to have you land on ground, Iolaire.
Yes, you did, Raziel, but we had to move quickly, Valerius replied with a sigh. Caden found himself chuckling at seeing how Valerius and Iolaire bickered. Valerius called out to the crowd,
Everything is fine. We just underestimated Iolaire's bulk.
Oh, not you too, Caden groaned. What? Never mind. Your platform was too weak.
It was. I am sorry about that, Valerius stated.
They grabbed something from a previous function. I thought it would serve.
I'm okay. I'm glad that everyone is all right, Caden answered.
Yes, indeed. You both did well, Valerius assured him.
Iolaire is fast, Raziel commented with approval.
Good catch, Iolaire, Shioni said with a laugh. She looked rather exhilarated.
Caden turned towards Simmy. The claw captain was blinking rather rapidly, but he gave Caden's a thumbs up.
Rose is going to tease us about having such a big butt that we broke the stage, Iolaire. You do know that, right?
Caden asked his spirit. Iolaire let out a laughing hoot.
There's nowhere to set us down, Shioni said with dismay.
Wait, Iolaire has an idea. Could you tell Shioni it'll be okay, Valerius? Caden asked.
The Dragon King raised an eyebrow.
Oh? What exactly is this plan?
But Caden didn't have a chance to tell him before Iolaire was putting it in motion. The White Dragon used its ice breath to create snow. On top of the broken platform, huge heaps of glittering snow was created. Iolaire moved its head back and forth to create another platform that was made of mounds of the fluffy stuff. Once the pile was deep enough and wide enough,
Iolaire landed once more. The final flap of wings caused snow to fly out over people in a wave of white. There were cries of delight as people laughed and shook off the snow that covered them. A few actually tasted it, likely to see if it was different from normal snow. There were some delighted looks on people's faces as the delicate snow touched their tongues. Iolaire gently placed Valerius, Shioni, and Simi down in the snow. They sank down to it up to their knees. Iolaire immediately began to compact the snow with its tail, front legs, and body, creating a rock-solid pack of snow that they could walk on almost the same as the wooden platform. Iolaire also created a ramp.
Is that for Valerius, Shioni, and Simi to leave, or...
Oh... You want the crowd to come up to it to pet you, Caden laughed. Iolaire hooted. It was determined to be petted now that it was here in front of the people.
Valerius be damned.
Shioni immediately leaned down, made a snowball, and tossed it at Valerius's chest. She had him dead on. Snow splattered his face too. He narrowed his eyes at her as she giggled and reached down again to form another snowball. Valerius reached down himself and gathered snow, sending a volley of them at the Sphinx shifter. Shioni laughed and tried to dodge, but quite a few of them hit. Both of them had snow in their hair, and their faces were bright with laughter. What could have been a disaster had turned into something wonderful. Caden saw that the crowd was filming and taking pictures.
I've never seen King Valerius like this, one woman exclaimed.
So playful, another said. He's always handsome, but he's just more, the first one giggled.
It's good to see him relaxed and not so grim, an elderly man noted.
It's the white dragon, a woman murmured, her eyes filled with a misty remembrance of something intensely pleasurable. He's met his match.
You don't think,
the elderly man broke off. Alarian might think he has a mate, the older woman answered, but I think we should believe our eyes rather than his arrogant words, don't you?
They're just playing in the snow. That's not romantic,
the elderly man said, but he was frowning as if he didn't altogether believe his own words. Caden knew his face would be flushed hotly if he had been in his human form overhearing that kind of speculation. He wondered if Valerius had caught an earful of it, but if the Dragon King had, he wasn't showing it. Valerius and Shioni were instead throwing snowballs at Iolaire. Caden urged Iolaire to douse them with snow. A blast of snow covered both of his attackers until they looked like snowmen.
Enough, enough, I give up, Shioni cried as she shook off the snow from her body.
We will continue this fight later, Valerius cried, but he was smiling.
Iolaire lifted its head into the air and let out a call of victory, which echoed around the square. There was laughter in response, but the white dragon preened.
Oh, I wish I could be in the snowball fight, too, a little girl cried as she tugged on her father's arm.
Iolaire lifted its head up and sent a stream of snow into the air that landed on the ground. There was laughter and gasps, and people scooped up handfuls of the stuff. People threw it at each other playfully. There was a sense in the air that one just couldn't get mad. This was fun. Iolaire then was chittering at him, gesturing towards the ramp. It was time to greet the people. He needed to tell Valerius.
Valerius, Iolaire wants the people to come to touch it.
The petting needs to begin, Caden said.
I think they are getting quite enough with the looking, Valerius said,
as he dusted snow off of his shoulders. He looked amazingly handsome. Iolaire, however, was not moved by his beauty. It wanted to be petted. Now!
Iolaire doesn't think so, Valerius.
Iolaire nosed the front of Valerius's chest, resting its snout lovingly against the Dragon King's skin. There were frantic cries of excitement in the crowd in response.
Oh my god, it's so cute! What does Iolaire want?
A young woman jumped up and down after she took several pictures.
King Valerius, don't make Iolaire sad. Do what he wants, her male companion called.
Iolaire hooted its agreement and pressed its nose harder against Valerius's muscled stomach.
Caden.
Don't Caden me. This is all Iolaire. It's threatening to breathe heavy and cause your robe to fly away, Caden chuckled.
Valerius's eyebrows rose up.
I have been seen, photographed, and filmed naked.
Yes, but this will be different. This will go viral even more than usual because it will be funny and sexy.
Oh, and it will have the white dragon in it, and Iolaire is convinced that it will be more beloved than you.
Caden paused as Iolaire preened.
I think it is because Iolaire believes it is cuter than you.
Raziel chuckled. The little dragon thinks it is cute. Yes, it is. But I am mighty.
Iolaire does agree with that, and noble, and a little scary, maybe a lot scary, Raziel, Caden admitted.
Yes, I am strongest. That is natural that I would be feared. But Iolaire does not need to be afraid. I protect, Raziel answered.
That's, good to know, Caden answered softly. Iolaire's breath puffed the robe back. Valerius, though, had it mostly clutched around himself with one arm. He petted Iolaire's nose. There was a chorus of, "Ah!"
There are people here who would love to hurt you, Iolaire. Now, I know they cannot, but even the attempt of it would be bad, Valerius said. Things have gone well so far, but we do not want to risk it.
Caden totally understood what Valerius was saying. This had been a great event. They shouldn't ruin it. But then Iolaire indicated to him a girl, likely about 11 years old, who was in a wheelchair at the front of the line with her mother and father. She gazed at Iolaire as if she couldn't quite believe that the white dragon was real. That gave Caden an idea.
What about just a few people, like that girl there?
Caden indicated the girl in the wheelchair. We won't let everyone up, but just a few, the children. That will make people feel good and not excluded. Iolaire was completely behind the plan, sensing that it was this or nothing, and this would be far better than nothing. Valerius considered this, absently stroking Iolaire's nose, which felt really nice. Finally, he nodded.
That is a good plan. Let me coordinate with Shioni and Simi.
The claw captain had retreated towards the barrier so that he could give them all as much space as possible. He immediately came back to Valerius. Shioni, who had been walking along the barrier, speaking to people, also finished up her greeting of the people and strode over.
What is it, my king? She asked. We are going to allow a dozen children, and their parents, obviously, to come in from the barrier to pet Iolaire. That young woman in the wheelchair should be the first one, Valerius gestured subtly with his head.
Shioni brightened. That's a wonderful idea.
It's a compromise, as Iolaire just wanted me to throw the barriers down so everyone could come pet them, Valerius remarked dryly with a smile towards the dragon.
Caden laughed. You are exaggerating, but not by much. Valerius shook his head.
You are both incorrigible.
But that's why you like us. Valerius's expression became almost smoky.
I enjoy you for many reasons. Now, let us do this. If anything goes wrong, however, I want you to fly away. Go to High Reach. No excuses.
Iolaire looked lovingly at Valerius.
I don't think Iolaire wants to leave you, Caden told him. I wouldn't want to either if there was trouble. Caden, I can take care of myself. I need you and Iolaire to be safe, Valerius said, reaching out and stroking their nose again.
But I'm a dragon, like you. Iolaire is a little smaller than Raziel, but still, Caden protested.
Caden? There was a warning note in Valerius's voice. There are so many things you left out in those statements that I cannot even count them. You will go to High Reach or no petting. That is my final offer.
Caden sighed. Okay. All right. We agree.
Good. Another pat.
And then Valerius went over to the microphone. A wave of excitement swept through the crowd. They sensed that something was about to happen. Already, the claw had brought up a dozen children with their parents to a part of the barrier. The girl in the wheelchair was in the front of the line.
We are arranging for a dozen children in the audience to come nearer to Iolaire. I know that Iolaire would like to meet every single one of you, but this is only the first of many times that Iolaire will be present for you to greet. So we're going to start small, Valerius told the crowd.
People erupted into cheers, yet it was clear that there were disappointed people in the crowd, but the choice of children had made the exclusion easier to swallow. Caden was relieved about that. He would have been bummed, too, before all of this had happened to him.
Come on, Iolaire, let's make ourselves as approachable as possible.
Iolaire settled down in the snow, tucking its legs beneath its body and curling its tail around its body. Its claws were drawn tight to its back. The pose reminded Caden of a cat.
A very large cat.
Iolaire's excitement was almost contagious. Caden liked people. Being in retail meant he had to enjoy interacting with them, but having them touch him was a little unnerving. Still, the sheer joy and shock on the kids' faces had him realizing that this was for them, not for him, and it really, really mattered for them to touch him.
Shioni, if you would do the honors and lead the children over to Iolaire, Valerius said.
Of course, my king, Shioni answered with a bright smile. Valerius went over by Iolaire's right shoulder and stood there with a hand on Iolaire's scales.
Be at ease, Valerius said.
I am. We are, Caden quickly amended.
Perhaps I am not, the Dragon King admitted with a quirk smile.
We'll be okay, Caden assured him. Shioni and the girl in the wheelchair were right in front of them then. Her parents were standing behind so as to let their daughter get the closest.
What's your name? Shioni asked as she dropped down on her haunches by the girl.
Kelly, she whispered, her eyes fixed on Iolaire. They were wide with wonder.
Well, Kelly, this is Iolaire, Shioni said.
Iolaire lowered its head so that its nose was 6 inches away from her, most definitely within touching distance. Caden could almost feel her utter love for Iolaire.
Would you like to touch Iolaire? Shioni asked. Iolaire wants you to touch it.
The girl merely nodded, clearly speechless. She lifted a hand from her lap. It was shaking. She gently placed it on Iolaire's nose. The moment that her fingers touched Iolaire, she let out a gasp. Tears started to run down her cheeks, not of sadness, but of profound joy. Caden could feel it. Iolaire let out a soft rumble, a purr.
Oh, 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 the little girl gasped. Oh, Mom, Dad, Iolaire is wonderful.
Her other hand was reaching out and she was petting the white dragon. Her parents were clutching at each other. Both were crying happy tears. Valerius suddenly said,
Let them come to Iolaire, Shioni. Let all the children come. It will be all right.
Caden touched the Dragon King's mind. At first, it was hard to read his thoughts, and then Caden saw them clearly.
You didn't know, Caden breathed.
No, Valerius answered.
You had no idea how much the dragons mean, how much you mean to everyone, Caden realized.
It is you they want, not me, not...
That's not true. They feel even more for you, Caden told him.
Valerius stroked Iolaire's shoulder.
Perhaps.
Caden sent a wave of love and tenderness towards the Dragon King as he sent,
Thank you, Valerius.
For what?
For everything, Caden said with a soft laugh.
Huh. But specifically, this time, for trusting the people and letting Iolaire have this.
I think it is for the people, Valerius answered as the kids crowded around Iolaire and petted it. There was laughing, squeals, and excited talking.
Yeah, I think you're right, Caden agreed.
Valerius met his gaze.
The truth is that you shouldn't be thanking me at all, Caden. It is you and Iolaire to be thanked.
Now it's my turn to ask you for what? Valerius smiled softly.
For changing everything. And I have a feeling that you're just getting started.
I hope you enjoyed this week's chapter. Just a reminder that if you join Wraith Reign as a member, the membership is 15 to 20 episodes ahead of the free podcast. If you'd like to join and listen to all those extra podcasts, not to mention getting access to the other stories and manga on Wraith Reign, a link is down below.